We just hit something on the taxiway. Could you tell us what it was?
You've probably seen the incredible photos and video from the September 10th incident already. It was on that day at Atlanta Hartsfield-Jackson Airport that the wing of a Delta Airlines Airbus A350-900 took off the tail of a CRJ900. With such a dramatic incident, there was, of course, a great deal of public speculation about fault and responsibility in the days following. But it was on October 9th, about a month after the incident, that we received official findings from the National Transportation Safety Board, which released its preliminary report on the ground collision. While there's still some time before the final report comes out, the initial findings have revealed key details about the series of events that preceded the incident. Let's examine everything the report has to say for today's video. First, a recap of what the public saw. It was on the morning of September 10th at Atlanta Hartsfield-Jackson International Airport that a Delta Airlines Airbus A350 and a Delta CRJ900 regional jet were involved in a ground collision. The wide-body aircraft sustained minor damage to one of its wings, but the regional aircraft had its tail section ripped off, as seen in images and videos circulated widely on social media. There were no injuries, and all passengers were reaccommodated on other flights. The Delta Airbus A350-900 was registered November 503 Delta November, while the CRJ900, operated by Endeavour Air, was registered November 302 Papa Quebec. The aircraft was being operated on behalf of Delta's regional brand, Delta Connection. At the time of this video's production, the A350 has not returned to service. Unsurprisingly, the 10-year-old CRJ900 also remains out of service and is likely a complete write-off. Setting the scene, the wide-body jet was preparing to depart for Tokyo Haneda as flight DL-295, while the smaller regional aircraft was waiting for its takeoff clearance to fly to Lafayette Regional Airport in Louisiana as flight DL-5526. The NTSB describes the actual collision as follows. The CRJ was holding short of runway 8 right on taxiway hotel waiting for takeoff clearance, and the A350 was taxiing along intersecting taxiway Echo. As the A350 passed behind the CRJ where the taxiways intersected, the right wingtip of the A350 impacted the vertical stabilizer of the CRJ, which resulted in substantial damage to the empennage of the CRJ and minor damage to the A350. Leading up to the collision, the A350 had pushed back from the terminal and was given instructions that eventually led it to taxiway Echo, where ground control instructed the flight crew to have the airplane follow the CRJ on taxiway Echo and switch to tower frequency. The wide-body jet's flight crew observed the navigational alert message NAV-GNSS-2 on the lower electronic centralized aircraft monitor and informed ATC that they would need to coordinate with maintenance before departure. ATC then instructed the A350 to continue straight ahead on taxiway Echo as able and hold short of taxiway Victor to fix the issue. The captain of the A350 explained that he was looking straight ahead and to the left to avoid the left wingtip from impinging on opposite direction traffic coming off taxiway Victor. But just then, the right wingtip of the A350 impacted the vertical stabilizer of the CRJ. For its part, the CRJ flight crew indicated that the airplane pushed back from the gate and that ground control instructed them to taxi to runway 8 right via taxiway Echo. The crew completed the before takeoff checks whilst on taxiway Echo, and ATC advised the crew that the A350 would wait for them and monitor the tower frequency for takeoff. The captain of the CRJ indicated that she maneuvered the aircraft to the hold short line on taxiway hotel, set the parking brake, and awaited further instruction from ATC. As you can see, it's all visualized with a Google Earth screenshot overlaid with the ground tracks of the A350 and the CRJ. The A350 is represented by the blue line, while the CRJ, the orange line. The white circle shows the location of the collision at the intersection of taxiways Echo and Hotel. It was quite obvious from footage, but the NTSB's report confirms that the CRJ was stationary. The report notes that the A350 was taxiing at a ground speed of about 12 knots. This is close to 14 miles per hour, or about 22 kilometers per hour. While a final report will come in a few months, this preliminary report ends crucially by stating that the distance from the hold short line to the nose landing gear of the CRJ was approximately 56 feet. So, taking it all in, you can tell from this preliminary report that its role is to present data and details while also explaining the situation and the series of events that led to the collision. It does not assign fault or responsibility for the collision. From what's presented in this report, however, we get some idea of how this collision happened, and it seems to be the result of several factors. The first is that the pilots of the A350 had their attention focused away from the CRJ900 on the right. In fact, the report states the A350 pilot was, quote, looking straight ahead and to the left to avoid the left wingtip from impinging on opposite direction traffic coming off taxiway Victor. We don't know exactly what the first officer was focused on at the time, but it's clear that the proximity of the CRJ900 to the right wingtip was completely missed as the wide body rolled past. Dealing with the navigational alert message may also have pulled attention away from the crew. A relief captain and a relief first officer were also on the flight deck of the A350. However, as some have pointed out, these crew members seated in jump seats positioned further back would not have been able to determine appropriate clearance distances. The second and perhaps more important factor is that the regional aircraft was approximately 56 feet or 17 meters back from the hold short line. It's a considerable distance, and one that may not have been necessary. For reference, the CRJ900's total fuselage length is about 118 feet or 36 meters. A third factor that could be considered is that the CRJ's position so far back of the hold short line, combined with the path of the A350, was missed by Atlanta's air traffic control. Of course, with Atlanta being one of the busiest airports in the world, it probably wasn't on the metaphorical radar of air traffic controllers as something that would be something to monitor. But, of course, these are just basic reflections based on the data presented. Again, we have to emphasize that the NTSB will be taking more time to review the data, conduct further interviews, and conduct analysis before explaining everything that happened through the full investigation report. But what do you think of the incident and the data presented by the NTSB? Would your thoughts on the incident be similar to ours? Are there other factors to consider? Leave a comment down below to let us know. Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.